वेलकम बैक टू माय यूट्यूब चैनल बायोशास्त्री नोडी कली केली तिली दिस इज माय सेल्फ सौधामिनीश्री शास्त्री येट विथ एन अनदर वीडियो ऑफ चैप्टर 12 सेक्सुअल रिप्रोडक्शन इन फ्लावरिंग प्लांट्स टुडेस टॉपिक इज एजेंट्स ऑफ पॉलिनेशन सो देर आर मेनली टू एजेंट्स ऑफ पॉलिनेशन वी कैन से टू टाइप्स दैट इज एबायोटिक एंड बायोटिक The abiotic includes wind and water. So the biotic type will include animal agents. So abiotic means all non-living things. And the biotic means the name itself indicates bio means living organism. It may be insects or it can be birds or some large animals. Clear? And one point you have to remember. To compensate the loss of pollen grains, the flowers produce enormous amount of pollen grains for the pollination to take place. So this point you have to keep in mind. This can be asked for a give reason how the pollen grains are compensated for the pollination purpose. So here you have to remember enormous amount of flowers are produced so that the amount of pollens will be available for the pollination. I hope it's clear. So next, pollination by wind or anemophily. The term anemophily means pollination by wind. Anemophily. Anemo means wind. Philly means type of pollination. Clear? So wind pollinated flower have certain characteristics like pollen grains are light and non-sticky. Why they are light and non-sticky? Because they can be transported in wind currents very easily. If they are heavy to carry in the wind current, it would be difficult. Then second, they often possess well exposed stamen. Why they are well exposed stamens? Why it has to be exposed? Because so that the pollens are easily dispersed into wind currents. That is why it is exposed to the environment. Then third point, they have a large, often feathery stigma. You know that birds have the feather. Why? To fly, isn't it? The same way they are can be easily trapped airborne pollen grains. Then they have a single ovule. How many ovules are there in each locule? They have a single ovule in each ovary and numerous flowers are produced. Next, fifth point. The flowers are not colorful. So here it should not be of any vibrant or colorful because there is no need here. However, it is carried away in the air currents, isn't it? So they are not colorful and do not produce any nectar. So here there is no necessity of producing the nectar because here neither insect is feeding on it nor anything such happening here because here only the abiotic factor is involved. So the flowers are produced and they have certain characteristics. This wind pollinated flower can be asked for 3 marks or sometimes it can be asked for 5 marks in the part D section. I hope it is clear. The example for wind pollinated flower is corn cob, the tassels. This you have to remember. This is one important MCQ for your CET and NEET. So give an example for wind pollinated flower, or they will give certain group of plants and it can be asked for which is a wind pollinated or which is a insect pollinated. I hope this concept is clear. Next, the important type of pollination, that is pollination by water. This pollination of water can also be called as hydrophily. Hydro means water, philly means the type of pollination taking place through the medium of water. You know that water is a regular mode of transport for male gametes. You know that the male gametes are motile and the female gametes are non-motile. You know all this concept, isn't it? So here we are concentrating this water is a regular mode of transport for male gametes among certain lower group of plants like algae, bryophytes and pteridophytes. Next, in case of aquatic plants such as water hyacinth and water lily, the flowers emerge above the level of water. This you have to keep in mind. It can be asked in your CT and NEET, the how the flowers will be either submerged or emerge above. So here the flowers emerge above the level of water and are pollinated by insect or wind. So you can see this, suppose this is a water level, so the flowers are above the level of water, so that it can be either pollinated by the insect or it can be by air current. Okay, so this is in case of the aquatic plants such as water hyacinth and water lily. So they can give a question like, in case of water plants like water hyacinth and water lily, how the pollination takes place? So many of the students will go wrong by seeing aquatic plants means here just merely the water pollination or hydrophily, they may tick the option, but you have to see that here the pollination is brought by either insects or wind. So there is a chances of abiotic factor as well as the biotic factor. Next, in case of Vallisneria, the female flower reaches the surface of water by the long stalk, and the male flowers or pollen grains are released onto the surface of the water. You can see the long stalk of the flower here, isn't it? The plant is somewhere here submerged and the flowers will have the long stalk and reaches the surface of the water. Okay, it reaches the surface of the water. So you can see the stigma part over here and the pollen grains will be released on the water surface. Why they are released on the water surface? Because easily they can swim along the water passively by the water currents and they can reach the stigma for the pollination. So this is just a hypothetical diagram so that it will be easy for you people to understand. Okay, so you can see the female flower this side and here from the male flower the pollen grains is released and the stigma, when it gets contact with the pollen grain, the pollination will takes place. So here you have to keep in mind in which plant the male flowers or the pollen grains are released on the surface of water. So that is in case of Vallisneria. You have to remember the name of the plant and where exactly the pollen is released, either on the surface or inside the water, that you have to remember. Next, in case of seagrass, the female flowers remain submerged. That is, submerged means they will be present under the water or inside the water and the pollen grains are released inside the water itself. Why? The female flower, since it is submerged, the pollen grains has to be released inside the water. So this is a type of plant where the pollen grains are released inside the water. Example, seagrass. So these concepts can be asked for you to explain the hydrophily in detail. For 5-mark question you can get, or sometimes explain the pollination in case of water hyacinth and water lily. They can give the name of the plant and they can ask you for 2 marks or 3 marks. So, and also explain the type of pollination in case of Vallisneria. This is one important question asked in your descriptive paper many a times. Okay, I hope this concept is clear for you. Next, the characteristics of wind pollinated flower. Once again, it is a 2-mark question in part B. So the pollen grains are long, ribbon like and are carried passively inside the water and hence only few reaches the stigma and achieve pollination. So what happens here is the pollen grains are very long because they have to swim, isn't it? So that is why they are ribbon like and are carried passively. That means here there is no expenditure of energy. Along the water current, the pollens have been carried out. Then pollen grains are protected from wetting by the mucilaginous covering. You know that if the pollen grains are staying inside the water, it should not get decay or decompose, isn't it? That is why the pollen grains have a protective covering called as mucilaginous covering. Next, pollination by animals or zoophily. This is also an important topic which can be asked for either 3 marks or for 5 marks in detail. So here mainly the pollinating agents are bees, butterflies, flies, beetles, wasps, ants, moths, even birds like sunbirds and hummingbirds, and also bats. These are the certain common pollinating agents. Bats are the dominant biotic pollinating agent. Larger animals such as primates like lemurs or even reptiles and garden lizards also acts as a pollinator. Hence animals get attracted to flower by color or by the fragrance. Here the animals, that means the living organism, isn't it? There has to be some kind of attraction between the flower and the particular pollinator, isn't it? The main attraction here is color or the fragrance. Many insects may consume pollen or the nectar without bringing about pollination. So some animals, like some insects are there, they consume the pollen and they have the nectar for free without doing any pollination. Such floral visitors are referred to as pollen or nectar robbers. So this is one important point you have to remember. It can be asked as a MCQ for your NEET and CET. When the animal visitor comes in contact with the anther and the stigma, the body of the animal gets a coating of a sticky pollen grains. What happens here? They get a coating of a sticky pollen grains, and on contact with the stigma, it brings about the pollination. This is how the pollination happens in case of the animal. Then the last concept of today's topic, that is characteristics of insect pollinated flower. So if one insect has to pollinate a flower, what are the characteristics should the flower should purpose? Let's see that. Flowers are large enough because it has to be very big enough so that the insect can come, they see visually vibrant colors and they get attracted. So flowers are large, colorful, fragrant and rich in nectar. Sorry for the background noise. When the flowers are small, a number of flowers are clustered. When there are many tiny flowers are there, they will be clustered into inflorescence and make them conspicuous. The flowers pollinated by beetles and flies secrete foul odors to attract the animals. So beetles and flies, they want some kind of attraction called as foul odors, which will be produced by the flowers. The nectar and pollen grains are the usual floral rewards. This is also an important point you have to remember for MCQ. So dash are the usual floral rewards like nectar, pollen grains, then some certain oils. So they will give all those points. So you have to remember the nectar and the pollen grains are the usual floral rewards. And these pollen grains are quite sticky. Floral rewards provide safe places to lay eggs. So this is one important section you have to remember. The example for this point is the eggs are laid at very higher height as seen in case of the tallest flower, Amorphophallus. Then example 2, in the relationship between the moth and the yucca. So this is asked many a times for 2 marks in your part B section of board exam. The moth deposits its egg in the locule of the ovary. That means in which location the moth will deposit the egg, it is asked in one of the MCQs. Okay, and the flowers gets pollinated by the moth. The larvae of the moth come out of the eggs, act as the seeds, starts developing. So this relationship, many a time it is asked for your 2 marks or some 3 marks question in a board examination. So mainly where, which location the moth will deposit the eggs, that is locule of the ovary. So the moth will bring the pollination in case of the yucca plants. So this is you have to remember. In today's session we saw about the agents of pollination, both the abiotic and the biotic. We saw about the anemophily, hydrophily, and then how the pollination is brought about by zoophily. I hope this video was useful for you. And if you like this video, please give up a big fat thumbs up. And those who are new to my channel, please do subscribe to my channel, Bioshastri Nodikali Kelitili. So here in my channel, you will see the concept, listen with my voice. So ultimately, you will understand the concept in a better way. Please share this content with your friends and family so that it will be beneficial for them.